Recorded Books presents an unabridged recording of Storm from the East, The Struggle Between the Arab World and the Christian West, by Milton Viorst. Narrated by Paul Hecht. This book is copyrighted 2006 by Milton Viorst. This recording is copyrighted 2006 by Recorded Books. We open this book with the following preface. This book, within the larger canvas of Arab history, focuses on the centuries-old contest for dominance between the Islamic East and the Christian West. The contest started in the 7th century, when Islamic armies organized by the Prophet Muhammad spilled out of Arabia into lands that were overwhelmingly Christian. In a series of stunning victories, they advanced as far as the Pyrenees in the west and the Bosphorus in the east. In just a few decades, they established the perimeter of what we now call the Arab world. Since then, momentous events have transpired, marked by ebbs and flows, but by few interruptions, in the conflict between two civilizations. The Crusaders seized Jerusalem in 1099, and a century later, the Muslims took it back, freeing the Middle East from Western forces for 600 years. In the 15th century, Christian armies drove the last Muslims out of Spain, ending the threat to Europe on one of its flanks, only to face a greater threat from the Ottomans, who inherited the Arab sword from the other flank. The Ottomans, in that era, captured Constantinople, the last great Christian stronghold in the East, and swept over much of Eastern Europe. Not until they were halted at the gates of Vienna, first in 1529 and again in 1683, was the West relieved of the Islamic threat. These pivotal events, though perceived from opposing perspectives, remain embedded in the collective memories of East and West. The present stage of the confrontation opened in the 19th century, when the West, superior now in organization and technology, began nibbling at the edges of the Arab world. The practice, called imperialism, acquired momentum with the Ottomans' fall in World War I, which left the Arab heartland without a defender. Within a few years, the West's political domination of the Arab region was joined to its quest for oil, but its efforts fed a commensurate growth of fiery Arab nationalism. Whatever the military mismatch, the West has not had an easy time subduing the Arabs. America's war in Iraq, igniting an explosion of Arab nationalism, is the latest round in this long contest. To see it otherwise is to deny the evidence of history. One clear lesson of the centuries of struggle is that both these civilizations possess enormous inner strengths. For the West to imagine it can impose its values on the East is a huge miscalculation. For the East to imagine the zealotry of its warriors can intimidate the West is naive. Another lesson is that neither has the power to choose the other's course. Though the confrontation is likely to go on, both sides can profit by lowering the stakes from an extended lull. Notwithstanding its military superiority, unless the West accepts the East's right to determine its own future, the bloodshed that currently marks the contest will continue. Both civilizations will clearly be the poorer for it. That is the message of this book. And now, Storm from the East.
Chapter 1. Memory. 622 to 1900. America's war in Iraq, from its start, did not go as President Bush's administration had predicted. Though the U.S. Army captured Baghdad and Iraq's other major cities easily enough, and encountered little resistance in abolishing the detested regime of Saddam Hussein, Iraqis did not greet America's forces with the gratitude that they had been told to expect. Far from treating America's soldiers as liberators, which is how they looked upon themselves, Iraqis regarded them as conquerors. It was a characterization for which most Americans were shockingly unprepared. Frustrated, the American invaders believed they were being misunderstood. The leadership in Washington had proclaimed repeatedly that its quarrel was not with the Iraqi people, but with Saddam's regime. It had assured its soldiers of the nobility of their mission, not just to end a dangerous military threat, but to wipe out tyranny and create the conditions for democracy. Wasn't that why the armies of their fathers and grandfathers had disembarked in 1944 in France to a delirious welcome by the local population? In 1945, moreover, the defeated Germans and Japanese, taking for granted the victors' benevolence, willingly established free and democratic regimes. So why were the Iraqis so hostile? Notwithstanding the political and cultural diversity among them, most Iraqis took the position that the American army was their enemy and placed serious obstacles in the way of its efforts to stabilize the country. This was the response of Sunnis and Shiites, Baghdadis and provincials, extremists and moderates, students, tribesmen, professionals, peasants, Saddam's followers and his foes. By the third year of the war, many Shiites, perceiving an opportunity to shift political domination to themselves, had adopted with some wariness a strategy of cooperating with the occupiers. Iraq's Kurdish community, to whom the occupation presented an opening to long-sought independence, did the same. But the once powerful Sunnis, with nothing to gain, waged a fierce insurgency against the occupiers. United in mistrust of the Americans, however, Sunnis, Shiites, and Kurds were all impatient for them to go home. Why were Iraqis so much more hostile than America's defeated enemies had been after World War II? Why, unlike the Germans and the Japanese, did they impugn America's ideals and objectives? Why, after President Bush declared mission accomplished, did Americans keep dying on the battlefield? Clearly, the leadership in Washington had initiated the war on the basis of a grievous miscalculation of Iraq and of the Arabs. What the American leadership had failed to calculate or simply dismissed was Arab nationalism. Much as Iraqis were driven by sectarianism, Sunnis versus Shiites, Arabs versus Kurds, a long history of hostility to foreign occupation served as a bond among them. Yet American leaders, in deciding to invade Iraq, chose not to take this bond and the deep emotions of Arab nationalism into account. Back in mid-2003, a few months after the invasion, when it looked to Washington as if its war had been won, President Bush was cautioned by French President Jacques Chirac about Arab nationalism, the power of which he had experienced as a young army officer in Algeria 40 years before. Chirac told Bush that Arab nationalism was a rising danger to Allied forces. "I cannot disagree with you more, Jacques," Bush replied. "Iraqis love us. We liberated them from a bloody dictator. The very few who fight against us are either remnants of the old regime, who are responsible for massive massacres and the use of torture chambers, or foreign terrorists who hate life itself. The bloodshed of the years since then has confirmed how poorly informed the American president was." To be sure, Germany and Japan, America's enemies in World War II, were driven by their own nationalism. But intrinsic to German and Japanese nationalism was a different conception of the United States, which imparted to both defeated peoples some confidence that the victor's presence, if not painless, might be benign. That was not true of Arab nationalism, which had embedded in it significant suspicion of, if not outright hostility to, the United States. America represented the Christian West, which had been the enemy of the Arabs for 1,400 years. The 20th century had been particularly catastrophic for relations between them. Then, on September 11, 2001, in the embers of the World Trade Center, the gap drastically widened. History had not been kind to the feelings between Arab and American cultures. It's fair to say that America, in initiating the war, had a duty to foresee, or at least to make a serious effort to foresee, what it would encounter among the Arabs. Arab nationalism was not a hidden phenomenon. Grasping its essence did not demand sophisticated minds, much less sophisticated secret services. The intelligence establishment's failures in bringing on the war have been amply documented. The blame for miscalculating what ensued after the American army rolled over Iraq must start with the president and be distributed among all those who advised him that Iraq's conquest would be, in the words of the CIA's director, a cakewalk. America had available the wisdom not only of distinguished scholars, but also of experienced diplomats and journalists. The literature was copious. Library shelves were crowded with basic information in books of history, religion and sociology, even poetry and fiction. The books didn't always agree. Nationalism by its nature is elusive. But America's leaders cannot be forgiven for dismissing the admonition to know thine enemy. They were derelict in their duty to consult the experts, crack the books. In an article in the New York Times Magazine, a revealing statement suggested that what was involved was more than neglect. It quoted a senior White House official who derided the reality-based community, men and women who believe that solutions emerge from your judicious study of discernible reality. In the Bush administration, the official told the writer, "We create our own reality. We are history's actors, and all of you will be left to just study what we do." The assertion, corresponding with what is publicly known of the process that led to the war, has the ring of accuracy. Its disdain for data expressed a worldview that diverges from centuries of Western intellectual tradition. In precluding the need for information, it conveyed a reliance on what can at best be called ideology, permeated by elements of the supernatural. It produced a war plan that left U.S. forces vulnerable to Arab fury, which they were not prepared to handle. Let us admit that Arab culture is, in so many ways, distant from Western experience. American education pays scant attention to the ideas and events that produce the Arab mind. Even at their most diligent, Westerners have a problem getting beneath the surface of Arab society. But that doesn't absolve the leaders who chose to initiate an invasion of Iraq of the duty to take account of the culture and grasp what the impact of an invasion was likely to be. Arab nationalism, the discernible reality that America's soldiers encountered, proved a powerful force for which they were in no way prepared. Nationalism, let us repeat, is not easy to define. Arab or other, it is not a doctrine. Nowhere is it rooted in critical thought, intellectual calculation, rationalism. Rather, it is an awareness, a consciousness, a frame of mind. Nationalism can be rash, even passionate, particularly in extreme forms. But at its core, nationalism is mystical. A nationalist need not be mystic, since even among the most cerebral, a space in the mind exists for mystical bonds. Love is an expression of these bonds. So is nationalism a kind of love. But what other than nationalism explains one's choking up over a symbol, a rectangle of often tattered or faded cloth whose design identifies it as a national flag? All nationalism emerges out of a community's shared memory. The memory isn't necessarily accurate, and it's rarely verifiable. It often embraces collective pride or shame. It may reach back beyond recorded history, but historical uncertainty does not weaken its hold. Nationalism is a mystical attachment to historical roots that guides a common destiny. For the Arabs, historical memory is the experience of a community whose members, with rare exceptions, are Muslim and speak the Arabic language. Though they are currently divided into many sovereign states and many more sects, they share an attachment to the Quran, the basic Muslim scripture. Almost all speak the language in which the Quran is written. For reasons of history, the Arab world is geographically and politically divided, but their religion and language unite the Arabs. So do the lessons, correct or not, they have learned from their history. Ibn Khaldun, the Arabs' greatest secular thinker, understood the tie between history and mysticism as long ago as the 14th century. He identified the Arab people with Asabiya, a term rendered as group feeling in the standard translation of his classic, The Mukaddima, an Introduction to History. Other scholars have translated Asabiya as tribal bonding, zealous partisanship, the collective will to power, and the sentiment of group solidarity that results from kinship, blood ties, and common descent. Each of these translations implies the presence of a mystical tie among Arabs. Ibn Khaldun attributes this tie to Islam. Writing in an age of Arab weakness, he laments that the Arabs, after Muhammad had transformed them from hostile tribes to a religious community, were not able to make better use of their asabiyya. Religion cemented their leadership with the religious laws and its ordinances, which explicitly and implicitly are concerned with what is good for Arab civilization. As a result, the royal authority and government of the Arabs became great and strong. Later on, they neglected religion. They were ignorant of the connection of their asabiyya. They became as savage as they had been before. They returned to their desert origins. The experience of bonding that is at the core of Ibn Khaldun's theories took place in the Mushrik, the Arabic word for the area encompassing present-day Syria, Jordan, Iraq, Lebanon, and Palestine. Geographers sometimes call it the Fertile Crescent. Though Islam was born in Arabia, the Arabs soon spread their faith and their power to the Mushrik, which became the heartland of Arabic culture. Though the links remain strong, the Mushrik stands apart from Egypt and Arabia. It stands even further apart from the Maghrib, Morocco, Algeria, Tunisia, Mauritania, Libya. The very name, which means the West, affirms its distance. It was in the Mushrik that the Arabs' collective memory and nationalism were formed. With deference to the contributions of the Maghrib states to Arab culture, it must be acknowledged that the Mushrik remains the Arab core, and so it will be the essential focus of this book. What, if anything, is special about Arab nationalism? Some historians argue that nationalism itself began only with the French Revolution, and that Arab nationalism resembles in part the veneration of statehood associated with 19th century Europe. But in fact, Arab nationalism barely resembles French nationalism. In different ways, Arab nationalism looks like the ancestral nationalism of the Chinese, the tribal nationalism of the Jews, the federal nationalism of the Swiss, and the multicultural nationalism of the Americans. The recognition that by themselves none of these models fit the Arabs, however, suggests a nationalism unique unto itself. In fact, to understand Arab nationalism, it's best not to try squeezing it into the categories that apply to other nations. The expression itself creates some confusion. In the 1950s and 1960s, Egypt's Gamal Abdel Nasser promoted Arab nationalism as an ideology that aimed to unify all Arabs into a single state. Arabs call this nationalism al-Qawmiyya. This book, to avoid confusion, will call it pan-Arabism. But Arab nationalism also refers to the loyalty called in Arabic al-Wataniya that Arabs feel toward their individual states. Readers have also become familiar more recently with Islamic nationalism, an offshoot of Arab nationalism. Arab nationalism is further complicated by the fact that the Arabs, except fleetingly under the Prophet Muhammad in the 17th century, have never, in a political sense, constituted a nation at all. But is politics crucial to the substance? If, as we noted, nationalism is a mystical awareness, a consciousness, a frame of mind. What we do know is that, elusive though the definition may be, Arab nationalism exists. It expresses itself every day, often violently, in Iraq, and it is more. As the vehicle for the Arab sense of community, for asabiyya, it drives politics throughout the Arab world. Arab nationalism, by any definition, was born in the arid desert of Arabia in the 7th century, when a simple trader named Muhammad brought the peninsula's warring tribes together under the umbrella of a new religion called Islam. As its leader, Muhammad described his political mission as a response to 20 years of revelations conveyed to him by God through the intercession of the angel Gabriel. The revelations were received in Arabic and later canonized as the Quran. Orphaned at a young age, Muhammad was raised by his maternal grandfather, then by an uncle, in the sun-scorched trading town of Mecca. No waters flow, not a blade of grass on which to rest the eye, a contemporary observer wrote of it. Only merchants dwell there. Though a town dweller, Muhammad absorbed the austere culture of the nomadic tribes, hierarchical, conformist, resistant to change, of the surrounding desert. As a reformer, he imposed a new sense of order within the context of these values. For more than a decade, Muhammad found few followers in Mecca. Then, in 622, faced with rising hostility among the merchants, he fled to the city now called Medina. Muslims regard the flight, called the Hijra, as Islam's founding event. In Medina, Muhammad gathered his followers and led them in battle against the doubters. Victorious, he superimposed on the tribal culture a higher loyalty, uniting believers into a religious community, the Ummah. Muhammad's genius lay in imbuing the Ummah's secular needs with religious force. Much of his vision came from the Christian and Jewish tribes of Arabia, from whom he surely absorbed the concept of monotheism. The Quran speaks respectfully of them as people of the book. But Muhammad was interested more in society than in theology. The vision with which he imbued Arabia's hostile tribes forged a nation. At its core was the Sharia, the body of law that fused secularism with religion, providing his followers with a pervasive guide to life. Though Arabs have since struggled with the idea of political nationhood, the Sharia remains at the heart of the Arab sense of community. Muslims were expected to live by the Sharia within the bounds of the Ummah. Unlike Christians and Jews, who historically were free to observe their religion under any national flag, for Muslims the community was intrinsic to the faith. It is no coincidence that Muslims divide the world into the Dar al-Islam, the domain of peace, and the Dar al-Harb, a perpetually hostile domain of war. Islam permitted the faithful, for tactical reasons, to observe truces with Christians and Jews, but its doctrine made clear that a truce was only a respite from the community's ongoing commitment to conquer disbelief. Though Islam adopted the monotheism of Christians and Jews and respects their book, the Bible, its attitude toward them has always been ambivalent. Islam holds both in awe. The Quran even instructs the Prophet, "If thou art in doubt concerning that which we reveal to thee, then question those," Christians and Jews, "who read the scriptures before thee." Over the centuries, Christians and Jews who dwelled among Arabs speaking Arabic have had social and financial burdens imposed on them, but until modern times, they have lived in security and comfort. yet at the same time, the Quran planted the seed of animosity. Fight against those who have been given the scripture and believeth not in Allah, it says, referring to the Christians and Jews of Arabia who rejected Muhammad's message. In another verse, the Quran declares, whoever seeketh a religion other than Islam, it will not be accepted of him, and in the hereafter he will be among the losers. Islam's claim was not so much that these faiths were in error, as that its own superior truth superseded their doctrine. The Quran, however, distinguishes Judaism from Christianity, to which it is more hostile. The explanation is that Christianity and Islam, being missionary faiths with pretensions to universality, have always been rivals. In doctrine, with each treating the other as heresy, they are each other's mirror image. Judaism, as a tribal religion, was historically exempt from Islamic animosity, but from the start, Christianity and Islam were competitors for global religious hegemony, making collision between them inevitable. These differences no doubt fed the sentiments now identified as nationalism in both the Christian and Islamic worlds. Nationalism is not just communal love. It also thrives on its enmities. In both civilizations, the loyalties that emerged toward those within were complemented by the fears, envy, and even hatred directed at those outside. As bodies of faith, Islam and Christianity, notwithstanding their concerns with the divine, have proven extremely effective in nourishing each other's disposition to be terrestrial enemies. That's apparent in the war being waged in the Middle East today. Though Saddam promoted a secularized nationalism, the fiercest opposition to the American presence has come from militants proclaiming their dedication to Islam. President Bush, in frequent public confessions of his own Christianity, has stoked the flames. A remarkably candid Pentagon analysis has recently argued that the war on terror, as the president named the conflict he has promoted since 9/11, was a cover. America, it says, is not responding to the threat of a rival power as it did in the Cold War. It is seeking to convert a broad movement within Islamic civilization to accept the value structure of Western modernity. This judgment, by the Pentagon's own analysts, puts its finger on what some scholars have designated a clash of Christian and Islamic civilizations. The Arabs, mobilized by Muhammad after the Hijra to Medina, established their domination over all of Arabia, then launched an empire heading west toward the Atlantic and east into Asia. In the decades after Muhammad's death in 632, they subdued Egypt, then swallowed up North Africa. They captured Syria and Iraq and drove the Byzantines back into Asia Minor. But for an inability to capture Constantinople and cross the Bosporus, they had all of Europe lying vulnerable before them. Adept sailors, they even advanced their conquests by sea, seizing most of the Mediterranean islands. Wherever they went, they spread their culture, absorbing the local population into the Ummah, the community of believers. The Arabs' conquests brought many non-Arabs into the fold. But the dominance of Arabic, the language of the Quran and of daily prayer, preserved the Arabs' preeminence in this diverse realm. Muhammad, however, was the last leader of a unified state. On the one hand, political fragmentation inevitably accompanied the swelling of the empire, reducing the Arab nation to an ideal. On the other hand, the steady spread of the Arabs' language and religion enlarged the sense of Arabism and expanded Arab nationalism's base. Muhammad's principal bequest to the Arabs was thus nationalism combined in religion and empire. But he also transmitted a military tradition, more often than not directed against Christendom. The Quran's admonition, "Begin not hostilities, for Allah loveth not aggressors," did not deter him. It was balanced by a commitment to jihad, a complex notion that includes the duty to spread God's truth to non-believers. Seven centuries ago, Ibn Khaldun wrote that in the Muslim community, the holy war is a religious obligation because of the universalism of the Muslim mission and the duty to convert everybody to Islam either by persuasion or by force. Many Muslims feel bound by this obligation today. The barriers to Islam's growth into Europe were Rome in the west and Byzantium in the east, both deeply Christian. It was natural for Muslims to conclude that Christianity itself was the essence of the Dar al-Harb, the domain of war. Curiously, the victorious Arab armies encountered little resistance to accepting Islam from the vanquished Christians in Asia Minor and across North Africa. Scholars agree that the conquerors rarely imposed conversion or punished those who declined to convert. Most willingly changed their faith. But substantial Christian and Jewish minorities, willing to concede Islam's preeminence, survived in an atmosphere of relative tolerance. In the centuries after the boundaries of the Arab world were fixed, Arab civilization retained communities of Christians as well as of Jews, significant reminders of the culture that had preceded it. Europe's Christians proved to be tougher adversaries than those in the south and the east of the Mediterranean basin. In 710, the Arabs crossed the Strait of Gibraltar into Spain, then followed the gaps in the Pyrenees into France. In a battle in 732, regarded as a milestone of history, they were stopped at Poitiers and began a long retreat. In Gibbon's famous phrase, "Had the battle gone otherwise, the Quran would now be taught in the schools of Oxford." Yet the Arabs remained in Spain for nearly eight centuries, and with their armies also encamped at the gates of Constantinople, they continued to threaten European Christendom from both flanks. The scholar Bernard Lewis describes Arabs and Europeans as intimate enemies in these centuries, though little about their relations was intimate. In fact, it's generally agreed that they had little contact with each other. Arabs and Europeans sometimes traded, but social exchange was rare, and Lewis himself makes clear that the Arabs knew very little about Europe's philosophy and science, or even its music and art. Though the two were sometimes at peace, or rather in an Islamically acceptable truce, they also did a great deal of fighting. At the least, they remained sworn enemies. For nearly a millennium, Christendom felt besieged by a vigorous Islam. The confrontation left deep scars on the collective psyche, or to use a contemporary metaphor, left traces in the DNA of both peoples. When its armies were brought to a standstill at the Pyrenees and the Bosporus, the Arab civilization was still at its apogee under the Abbasids, their grandest dynasty. Europe in the 9th century was in the dark ages of clerical domination and superstition. The transformation that the Renaissance would ignite was still far off. The Abbasid caliphs, the religious and temporal leaders of the Arabs, were much more powerful than any European king. Convinced that the halt to Islam's forward movement was more Europe's loss than their own, Arabs saw Europeans as barbarians, a judgment that at the time contained much truth. Yet the judgment was also rich with hubris, derived from Islam's confidence that it had the answers to life's problems. Baghdad in that era took pride in its astronomers and mathematicians, architects and poets, and the natural scientists who advanced the frontiers of medicine. This was the Arabs' golden age, but it ended abruptly, leaving a nostalgia that is also embedded in the Arabs' DNA. The loss has imbued them with feelings of self-reproach and a nationalism notable less for its pride than for its anger. The abruptness of the Arab decline is subject to diverse explanations. The simplest is that the endemic misrule and economic lethargy of the Abbasid era were quicksand on which a sound Arab society could not build. The Arabs' contempt for Europe provides another clue. Islam's refusal to open itself to a measure of reason, to acknowledge free will, to embrace the virtues of innovation and creativity also exacted a price. Its closed doors produced a socially coherent but stagnant civilization. That its outlook has scarcely budged in 1,000 years raises major questions about the Arabs' current prospects for resurrecting their golden age. It is worth digressing to note that under the Abbasids, a school of religious dissidents called Mu'tazilites challenged Islam's orthodox clergy to widen the intellectual boundaries of the faith. They were guided by the classical thinkers of ancient Greece, whose works reached them through Byzantium. In this contest, the clergy were victorious, reaffirming the immutability of Islamic doctrine, while the ideas championed by the dissidents ironically gravitated westward from Baghdad to seed the Renaissance. At a time when the Arabs were rededicating themselves to the austere desert code with which Islam began, the Renaissance was undermining Christian rigidities, imparting new dynamism to Western culture. It can be fairly stated that Islamic orthodoxy's triumph a millennium ago left the Arabs impaired to this day in their ability to compete in a changing world. Some 4 centuries after Muhammad initiated Islam's great campaign of conquest, the Crusaders from Europe launched Christendom's first strategic counterattack. By then, Arab hegemony in the Mashrek region had deteriorated. The Baghdad caliphs had ceded fundraising to greedy minions and had replaced their Arab warriors with conscripted armies of Turkish slaves, Mamluks, a peculiar Islamic institution. Civil strife raged at the fringes of the Arab world. In 954, a Persian chieftain occupied Baghdad. By the time the Crusaders took Jerusalem in 1099, Christian forces had also regained much of Spain. Powers even more menacing to the Arabs loomed east of Persia. The Seljuks, a tribe of Central Asian Turks who had converted to Islam, captured Baghdad in the 11th century, then took Syria and Palestine. In the 12th, Saladin, a Muslim Kurd, founded a dynasty in Egypt and became an Islamic hero by driving the Crusaders from Jerusalem. His dynasty soon gave way to Mamluks, however, who finished the task of expelling the Crusaders. But in the next century, the Mongols, arriving from Eastern Asia, devastated Iraq, killed the last Abbasid caliph, and razed Baghdad. Though Islam itself survived and even thrived under the leadership of the non-Arabs, the Middle East was transformed, with the Arabs no longer at the center of great events. In the 14th century, the Ottomans, a tribe that had followed the Turkish practice of converting to Islam, established their dominion in the east over their rivals. The Seljuks, whose rule was disintegrating, then advanced westward through the Balkans. In 1453, Ottoman armies finally captured Constantinople, putting an end to the 1,100-year-old Byzantine Empire, and within a few decades they established hegemony over nearly the entire Arab world. Maintaining their pressure on Eastern Europe, in 1683 they reached the gates of Vienna, the farthest advance in the campaign of conquest that Muhammad had launched 1,000 years before. Their defeat at Vienna, barely 3 centuries ago, marked Islam's last serious threat to the Christian West. The Arabs were subjects of the Ottoman Empire for 400 years. Yet, in the Arabs' historical memory, it's hard to detect animosity toward the Ottoman conquest. They never thought of these centuries as occupation, and until the very end, they showed no signs of rebellion. They expressed little resentment at submitting to other Muslims, whether Saladin's Kurds or the Seljuk and Ottoman Turks. To be sure, Arabs regretted surrendering their preeminence within Islam, particularly after the Ottomans took over the office of caliph, but they found solace in the Ummah, in membership in the Muslim community. Even after the Crusades, it was the infidel Christians whom the Arabs continued to regard as irredeemable enemies. In the historical memory of Arabs today, the Crusades are a contemporary conflict. Their name for the Crusades is the Frankish Wars, and they still refer colloquially to a European as a frange, as if he were mailed, and on horseback, wearing a cross on his chest. They think of the Crusaders' expulsion from the Holy Land as their own victory, notwithstanding Saladin's Kurdish identity. Instinctively, they call Israel a Crusader state. Young Arabs on Baghdad streets denounce the Western soldiers in Iraq as Crusaders, and when President Bush referred to his war on terror as a crusade, many took it not as a slip of the tongue, but as conclusive evidence of a new round in the age-old struggle. For the four centuries of Ottoman rule, the Arabs had no collective identity as players in world events. The Ottomans had declared their sovereignty over the Arabs' holy cities of Mecca and Medina, and in laying claim to the caliphate, snatched away what the Arabs had considered their religious birthright. It's true that as rulers, the Ottomans imposed no special burdens on the Arabs. They posed no obstacles to the survival of Arabic and Arab culture. They were fair in distributing civil and military offices, as well as places, few as they were, in Ottoman schools. If
Arab societies. We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.